Broadcasting live from the Business Radio X studios in Atlanta, Georgia, it's time for Atlanta Business Radio. Brought to you by OnPay. Built in Atlanta, OnPay is the top-rated payroll and HR software anywhere. Get 1 month free at onpay.com. Now, here's your host.
Lee Cantor here, another episode of Atlanta Business Radio, and this is going to be a good one. But before we get started, I'd like to thank our sponsor, OnPay. So please support them so we can continue to share these stories. Today on Atlanta Business Radio, we got Andre Flewellen, and he is with Beyond the Game Network. Welcome, Andre.
Hey, Lee. How are you doing today?
I am doing great. Tell us about Beyond the Game Network. How are you serving folks?
Sure. So just a little bit about me, my backstory. So I'm a former NFL player, played 8 years, actually from Cartersville, Georgia, Cartersville Purple Hurricane, Cartersville High School is where I went. Went to Florida State University, and like I said, played most of my career with the Detroit Lions as a defensive tackle for 8 years. So, you know, I'll give you the backstory about me because it kind of ties in a little bit to what we do now with Beyond the Game. But while I was playing, I'll never forget this moment. It's one of the defining moments of my career. My locker was wedged between Ndamukong Suh, who's one of the best defensive tackles of all time, and Calvin Johnson, who is probably arguably one of the best receivers of all time. Okay. So every single day in the locker room in Detroit, I used to steal Calvin Johnson's shower shoes to go take a shower because they fit me perfectly. And every single day, we would have an argument about me stealing his shower shoes. And we kind of got into it. We're really good friends, but we kind of got into it. So for whatever reason, one of these days we're having this argument and Sue is beside me cracking up and me and Calvin are going back and forth. It just hit me. I said, whoa, hold on. I'm having an argument about shower shoes with one of the most influential people on the planet. And then I looked around the locker room and I said, hold on. There's 53 of the most influential people on God's green earth in one room. And all we do together as a team is play a sport. That's it. And so then I started thinking, like, what if we started doing things off the field like we do on the field, right? And I'm not even talking about pulling people, you know, pooling collective income. I said, what if we pulled our collective influence just to do stuff off the field? It'd be impossible for us to be unsuccessful. So I tried to get that done while I was playing, but, you know, guys are focused on playing football when they're focused on playing football. It wasn't really too many other folks. And that's kind of how it should be. So I kept that idea around for the next 4 years until I ended my NFL career. And I really said, like, I want to start a group of athletes that come together off the field to do life as a team. That's the way I put it. And that was the birth and conception of what Beyond the Game is today. That's really where it came from. That's the backstory.
So now when you're explaining that to other athletes, is that first you have the credibility, obviously, of being in the NFL and kind of living the same life that they've lived and understanding that just from a highly empathetic standpoint. Once they leave the game, is that a difficult transition for athletes in terms of their identity and maybe a lot of their self-worth is I'm an athlete and now I got to transition to kind of a different game for the rest of my life? Does this kind of when you can create this network and give them a purpose, does this make that transition easier?
It does. You know, and so the way I love telling it like this so people can really get just how deeply how hard it is for athletes to make that transition. Let's say that there's been a doctor, right? He has been a doctor. He is 50 years old. He has been practicing for 20 years. Post-residency and all that, right? Seasoned doctor, has a practice and everything. And then one day, the Georgia Board of Doctors of Association, whatever it is, they come and say, hey, we're shutting down your practice. And he says, why? He says, because we want to. He says, that's not fair. And they say, tough luck. And he said, but no, I built this practice over the last 20 years. I don't know. I don't have anything else to do. I'm a doctor. This is what I do for a livelihood. They say, tough luck. There's some other younger doctors out there, and we think that they're better than you, so we're shutting you down. And that is exactly what happens to every athlete almost that goes through it, right? It is that doctor in that situation would lose his or her mind. Like, seriously, and that's what would happen. And that's what happens to a lot of athletes post-career is I've been doing this thing for 20 years. I am the highest of the highest of the highest percentile of what I do on the planet. And then it's just taken away from it because there's somebody younger with somebody who they think is better. And it's just, it's traumatic. And so when I saw that, I just wanted us to be a group of, you can find your next purpose post-career with our group. And the way that we structured it is, see, it's not just about athletes, but there, it has to be about business executives too. So we have an athlete network and we have a business executive network. And they're equally important because as an athlete, again, I've been playing football for 20 years. I ain't got any business experience, but these business executives have had, you know, 20, 25, 30 years of business experience. So now we join forces together and create this perfect team of athletes and business executives coming together to win in life. So that's where it really kind of, you know, the rubber meets the road is the business executive network along with the athlete network.
And then when they're combined, what sort of things are they combined to do? Are they involved in nonprofits? Are they involved in business, like creating business? How do they kind of work together?
Yeah, so we do have a third spoke. So we have the athletes and we have our business executives. But so what Beyond the Game as a company does, Beyond the Game invests in startup businesses. We're a venture capital group. And so basically the cool thing about it is for a startup founder, right? You know, founders in the early stages, they need credibility. Like that is their thing that can get them to the next step. They need credibility, even though they need money, because a lot all the founders need money. But at the same time, they need credibility and they need influence. So we have our business executives. They'll write the checks. That we have a network that writes the checks. So none of our athletes actually invest their own money. They'll write the checks. And so then only writing checks into companies or funding companies that our athlete network could get behind and make them more successful. So it wouldn't be like a business-to-business company or anything like that. It wouldn't really fit in terms of our investment criteria. But a fitness company or something like that would. And that's what's happened. So now when our business executives write these checks, our athletes now have opportunities to do some brand ambassador, influencer marketing work for these companies and get equity or cash from these different companies. So that's how our quote unquote flywheel works is our athletes have influence, our business executives will write the checks, and then the startup founders are a way to get the athletes equity and access to do awesome things. And that's how Beyond the Game works in its own little ecosystem.
And that's a big kind of a differentiator for you and your firm compared to all those other kind of activities that are trying to leverage the wealth of the athlete rather than their influence. So wealth and maybe the influence is nice to have, but in your case, you're not putting any of the athletes' money at risk, really. It's just they're risking some of their reputation and some political capital, maybe, and influence.
Right. Yeah. You know, and we've seen that because the way we look at it, so you look at somebody like LeBron James, who has his own investment group and does a lot of venture capital investments. I mean, LeBron's going to win because he's LeBron. And just think about it like this. If LeBron loses 100 of, like, let's say 100 of his startups that he invests in fail, he's still LeBron. He still has so much capital to work with that those losses don't really touch him. But in our network, we realize, man, there's way more non-superstars than there are superstars, right? There's way more non-LeBron Jameses than there are. And so it's just not wise, especially with risky investments like venture capital, especially, and their long-term illiquid investments. It's just not wise, especially within the first few years of retiring from the NFL where you hadn't had that steady base of income coming in. It's just not a good decision to be investing in these risky startups. It's not wise. And you don't have to, because we believe that influence is greater than income. That's what we always say. So instead of investing your hard-earned money, right, invest your influence, right, and take a risk off of that instead of your money. That's the way we look at it.
And so they're starting maybe by first risking influence, but as they build more and more wealth, then they can be LeBron-like and take more and more risks investing their capital into the startups as well.
Absolutely. And, you know, and honestly, the way that this came about is I had to learn it the hard way. Like, I really did. I had to walk the walk. I tried to get into investing when I was done playing. I got my Series 7 and Series 66. I thought I was going to be a stockbroker and a wealth advisor. And I tried to do my own startup investing. And, man, I got absolutely crushed in investing because I was trying to do it alone. I had no idea what I was doing. Everybody's pitch sounds good when they want your money, right? Like, that's just the way it's, that's the way it's built. That's the way it's set up. And so, you know, and that's the one thing, you know, with our athlete network, like, we take them through our rigorous, like, investment, you know, our investment protocol. Like, we take them through and we tell, we have a, we call it a no document. And we say, look, if you're, if a, if anybody comes to you with a pitch and it doesn't check every single one of these boxes, it's an immediate no. And if it does check every one of these boxes, then you take it to Beyond the Game's investment committee. And then we'll all look at it together as a team. And if we all deem it's okay to invest, then you can make the choice if you want to invest or not. But like, you got to have that no document because, man, it's just everybody's pitch sounds good until you dig into the details.
Right. There's a mentor of mine that says it's either a hell yeah or it's a no.
That, I'm stealing that. I love that. That hey, seriously, I love that. Exactly.
So now the companies you invest in, you mentioned fitness, I would imagine kind of supplements. You're in and around the space that you occupy. Have you started doing the investment yet? Like what stage of a company are you right now? How big is, where's the network at? Yeah.
So we've made 12 investments so far. We're actually finalizing our 13th investment next week. And they're all, you know, sports, media is a good one. Fitness, consumer goods, esports, gaming, they're all kind of in that sector. Some, you know, some clothing, things that, you know, our athletes can get behind. So we've made, you know, we've actually made 12 investments. And it's really cool just kind of going with the times that we're in right now. Nine of our 12 investments that we've made have had a minority or female founder, right? Which is one of their founding member team, which is really, in terms of the venture capital world, is 9 of 12 is a really, really high ratio to have that. And so, it's really cool because the times that we're in right now with, you know, the racial injustice and racial inequality and stuff like that that's going on, like beyond the game, we can proudly say that we've been investing, we've been kind of championing this cause for a while now. And it's not because we've been trying to pick out just minority and female founders. Now we've just been finding the best founders. And these founders happen to be just that. So, you know, it's really cool just from what we've done, you know, how we've grown in these 12 investments, that we can really say that, man, we're not just trying to do things just to, you know, just to make a check, but also we're doing the right things. So it's really good.
Now, how are you attracting the athletes? I assume you started out in the NFL, but I would also assume that you're trying to go beyond that at some point.
Yeah. So, you know, we started out, so we actually have mostly NFL. Then we have, WNBA. We have major, we have a extreme snowboarder. Like we actually have a few, other sports. So that's what I wanted. Like I wanted this group to be not just a group of just athletes, I mean, just football players, but also, man, we want this to be, because each individual sport or each individual gender has a specific kind of role that they could fit in to, you know, to help startups, help founders, and also just kind of make this thing bigger. So it's all sports, and that's the goal.
And then it's growing, the athlete side is growing word of mouth.
Yeah. So pretty much I just reach out to people that I know, and I'll see, you know, I'll say, hey, you know, just, I'll give them the information. I'll say, hey, you know, join our group. And it mostly comes from, you know, my network. And then other people are starting to refer other people to our network. So it's just, it really is just growing word of mouth. So which is authentic, and that's how we want it.
Now, talk a little bit about the pitch battle.
Yeah. So we're super excited. So now talking about those, you know, 9 of those 12 investments have been, you know, African-American or female founders, minority founders. So we started looking at what could we do with what we have, right? With Beyond the Game, like with the current economy and the current situation in the United States, like what can we do to make our little mark, you know, little or big mark, on what's going on? How can we help? And, you know, one thing I'm really big on is just doing what you can do with what you have, right? Not trying to do stuff that other people can do, but like what fits us. And so we have venture capital, you know, we have business executives, we have a group of athletes. And we said, look, well, let's put on a pitch competition. And we've actually had this idea for a long time now. But let's put on a pitch competition for Black founders. Because, you know, a lot of them are not getting the shots. And they're good founders. They're just not getting the shots or the exposure that, you know, that we think they can get. So, you know, so that's when we started. We put together a pitch battle, and we have some awesome, awesome judges. So basically, it'll be three African-American founders, and this is all virtual. We'll be pitching to three athlete judges. So the first judge we have right now is Cliff Averill, who's a Pro Bowler, Super Bowl champ. He's been a venture capital investor himself. He actually invested in Topgolf in the early stages, so he's been doing really good with that. So super excited about him being on. And, you know, and it's just a way for us for Beyond the Game to do our part to help out what's going on in this country right now. So I'm very excited about Pitch Battle. There will be, you know, we're working on different media partners and things like that. So we're super excited about how things are moving along. So, yeah, Pitch Battle is going to be something special. And it's something that I hope that we can do multiple times a year, not just one.
Yeah, and you could do it for different groups. I can do a women one. It would be exciting to kind of see that play out.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely, yeah. So, and that's the goal. Just, you know, we just think right now for what's going on right now, it's just the best thing to do. But also, man, as we move forward, you know, there's multiple ways that we could do it. So very excited about Pitch Battle. You know, we definitely applications are open for founders. Right, you know, it's on our website, and I can give you that at the end. And just really excited about just how that we can make a difference.
So now, what do you need more of? How can we help?
Absolutely. So, you know, one thing we need more founders to apply. So you can, you know, apply at our website. It's thebtgnetwork.com/apply. Right. Or if you can just type in thebtgnetwork.com, and then there's an icon you can click that says apply. We all definitely need help with that. We're just getting the word out because this is a produced show. So the way we're doing it is we're not doing it as just a Zoom call and, you know, and a live Zoom call. That's it. Like, it's actually going to be a filmed, edited, and produced show. So it's going to look very, very similar to like a Shark Tank style or something like that. So also, man, you know, distribution is going to be very, very important for us as well, because obviously we want as many eyes as possible to see it, and just support, you know, just support our cause, just help get the word out. That just all those things, you know, every little thing helps, and I'm always appreciative of anybody doing anything helps us out.
Good stuff. Well, congratulations on all the success, and the website one more time is thebtgnetwork.com. You can go there and apply. You can go and check out the mission. And if you're an athlete, go give Andre a call and see if you can get in.
Absolutely. And you can always find me on my, you know, I'm pretty active on social. So you can always find me on my Instagram or Facebook or Twitter. It's just flutcom, FLUDOTCOM. So flutcom spelled out. That's all my social handles. And yeah, you know, just anybody, you know, I'm always good with people doing good. I'm always happy, right? There's so many, you know, messed up things going on right now. I'm always good when people are doing good. So that's, we're just trying to do a little bit of good in this world.
Well, we appreciate you and your work. Thank you for sharing your story today.
Oh, man. Thank you for having me on.
All right. This is Lee Cantor. We'll see y'all next time on Atlanta Business Radio. And remember, we could not be sharing these stories without the support of our sponsor, OnPay. So please support them so we can continue to share these important stories.
Today's episode of Atlanta Business Radio is brought to you by OnPay. Built in Atlanta, OnPay is the top-rated payroll and HR software anywhere. Get 1 month free at onpay.com.